Hello and welcome to Citizens Forum. This is being filmed on Wednesday, July the 16th in the Memorial Arena in Victoria. I'd like to start by thanking our volunteer crew and the Shaw staff that makes it all happen. The first part of Citizens Forum is usually the Walter and Jack show, but Walter is back east, so we've got even better, the Chris and Jack show.
And I wouldn't say even better. Now, Jack, you're setting me up.
Chris Cook is the host of Guerrilla Radio on CFUV Radio in Victoria, which is community radio, and also the publisher-editor of PacificFreePress.com. Two things to definitely look at. And Chris, what do you want to start off with?
Well, it's Wednesday, July 16th. Today, Israel has been bombing Gaza for 10 days now. There was breaking news today that they'll stop tomorrow. The United Nations has asked them to take a cessation of hostilities. For how long, I'm not sure. But to date now, it's more than 200. The numbers vary, but it's around 230 people in Gaza have been killed. There was one Israeli who was killed yesterday as well, the first to die. I mean, the funny thing in this is it keeps being reported, especially on the CBC, as a war. And this is hardly a war. This is the fourth largest military in the world, and one of the most modern ones, right alongside the United States with technology, dropping bombs on a civilian population. Most of the people, 80% is some of the estimates, the people killed in Gaza are civilians. 20% children. You know, I mean, this isn't a war. This is a massacre. As we've seen before, you know, we saw this in 2008 and 2009, where 1,500 approximately Gazans were killed in the same manner, but in a 22-day campaign. So we're halfway into it, so there's less loss of life this time, but still a significant number. And you know, when we talked about this, Jack, some years ago, because 2012 was another instance where we saw the same pattern played out to this pretty, you know, much the same results. And then at that time, you may recall, I brought in a bottle of pennies to try to give some kind of visual representation of just what this means. These numbers, I mean, it's difficult to understand. So if you'll allow or
bear human, with me,
I've done the same again, but this time instead of pennies, because in those days we still had pennies, and now I couldn't find enough pennies to represent the number, but I've got dimes here. I don't know if Mazin, are you going to get this? This is, each one of these coins represents a single individual killed in Gaza in the last 10 days through this violence, this mayhem. Now, these represent lives, fathers, brothers, cousins, daughters, aunts, nieces, friends. You know, 80% of those are civilians, 20% are children. Now, there is a further irony, Jack, in that I use dimes this time, because another thing that's become evident during this latest massacre is the use of the so-called dime weapon, and it's an acronym.
Yeah, I've never really heard of it.
Well, the dime is D-I-M-E for dense, inert, metallic, explosive. And the first time this was seen was during the 2006, when Israel was at war with Lebanon. They were also bombing Gaza at the same time. I'm not even sure what the reasons preferred then, or if any, were, but it was happening. And doctors there were finding these bizarre injuries. One guy, a doctor who had been in war zones for 30 years and more, he says, was seeing wounds that he didn't know what they were. He had no idea. He'd never seen anything like it. And nobody had, because these weapons were brand new, being tested, in fact. And some people think that's the only reason that they were bombing Gaza, was to test, as a testing ground for these weapons. And they are outlawed internationally, but now we find Israel is using them again, and white phosphorus, as we saw them using in 2008 when the UN the UN compound where people were taking shelter was bombed with this white phosphorus.
Nobody or most people don't know what white phosphorus is.
Well, the Americans used this in Fallujah as well. It's illegal to use in the manner it is, but it was originally, the white phosphorus was originally designed to, it burns incredibly brightly, incredibly hot, and you can't put it out with water or anything. The kind of wounds it creates are awful, a burning that cannot be extinguished. It's horrific. The dime weapon is the dense, inert, metallic explosive, was designed to be a very pinpoint kind of rock, mounted on a rocket for drones or whatever. And so say I wanted to kill an individual, I could zone in on his cell phone maybe. If I shoot a Hellfire missile at him, I'll get him, but I might kill everybody within 100 meters radius of him. Well, what if I could use a weapon that would only destroy the living things within a 10-foot radius? So the collateral damage, as they name the human beings chewed up in this manner, would be minimized. So how they've done that is they've made this weapon with very, very fine particles of tungsten and some other metals too. They're inert, which means they're not a part of the explosive process or anything. They're just shrapnel, but very, very, very fine. And when these things go off, they accelerate at such a speed that they, in effect, just sever everything in the kill radius. Like, they'll cut you right in half so cleanly that you won't even bleed. The problem is that these things do, the particles get into people further away. And they're not fatal, but they are a carcinogen. And so this is a cancer-causing weapon as well as a terrifyingly effective. And the doctors, in seeing these wounds, would see, limbs of people that were too close to the target just completely severed, and cleanly cut off. And, it's another of the horrors employed.
I seem to remember going back a couple of weeks, there was talk of an agreement between Hamas and, is it still called the PLO or Fatah?
Yeah.
And which seemed to be, I don't know if that was positive or negative, I guess depending.
Well, it goes back further than that. Israel has often said they won't talk to Hamas because this is the government, the elected government of Palestine.
So is Hamas right now the elected government in Palestine?
Elected authority in Palestine, but there was a civil war that was fueled by Israel and America. They armed the Fatah to fight. They thought that Fatah would overthrow Hamas, and things went the other way. But Hamas is confined to Gaza. So in the West Bank, you still have Fatah. Although their leader, Abbas, his election mandate ran out 5 years ago, or maybe 6 years ago now, but they just never had any other elections. So he doesn't enjoy very much support, popular support, but he's still the face that you always see in negotiation talks or anything like that. But Israel said they won't talk to Hamas, and they can't talk peace because they don't have a partner to talk peace to. They said the same thing about Arafat years ago. Well, finally, the Hamas and Fatah, who have been at each other's throats literally, decided they would get together, that they would form a unity government. And this is the news that you refer to, was the announcement that they had, after all this acrimony, they had agreed to form a unified Palestinian authority, although not by that name, and that this presumably would then get rid of Israel's claim that they had nobody to talk to, because of the factions in Palestine. Well, Israel immediately said they didn't want it. They didn't recognize it. They still wouldn't talk to Hamas. And they've been doing everything they can in the background, and many posit that this is a big reason for this latest Gaza thing. It has nothing to do with the three teenagers that were abducted in the West Bank by people as yet unconfirmed. But Netanyahu and his government have repeatedly claimed it was Hamas that was behind this, there's not a shred of evidence in that whatsoever, but that's the claim, and some of the blowback to that has been really horrific for Palestinians living especially in the West Bank. I mean, outside of what's going on in Gaza, they've been targeted, settlers have been running people over with their cars, and you're not hearing much about what's going on there, but you know, it's a Kristallnacht or something all over again, you know. But so anyway, yeah, you're right, Jack. There was talk and there was unification, and there is unification at this moment, but it's not being recognized by Israel or the United States or Canada, of course.
What do you think of the media coverage that we're getting? I've basically stopped listening to what our Canadian media says on all important issues because I just don't believe it anymore, but it seems to be, from what I'm seeing, complete, once again, this one-sided, that it's always the Palestinians' fault and Israel is always retaliating, and you know, it doesn't seem like a fair representation ever of the truth of what's going on.
Yeah, truth. I still watch the CBC and I listen to the CBC radio news during the course of the day because I think it's my duty to do it. I mean, they are reporting in my name. My taxes are paying for it, and I just feel that it, you know, I have to watch it. You're quite right. I take a very Orwellian view of what they report and how they report it, especially on issues, big international issues of war and peace, and especially with the Israel-Palestine question. I mean, I was listening to the CBC Radio 1 news today, and they were talking about the latest from Gaza, and the language that they use, and language is important, you know, they insist on calling this a war. Now, in my mind, a war is when you have two, you know, factions of similar construction facing each other off in a more or less equal way. Bombing civilians is, I mean, was it a war when Germany dropped bombs on Spain in 1938, you know, at Guernica? You know, this was the famous painting by Pablo Picasso that hangs yet in the United Nations. It was a horror, and you know, civilians being bombed with no way to resist, no way to fight back. Well, this is what's happening in Gaza, but it's acceptable. It's acceptable now to Canada. Jack, allow me. I mean, Canada calls on its allies and partners to recognize that these terrorist acts by Hamas are unacceptable and that solidarity with Israel is the best way of stopping the conflict. This is the Canadian government position, our Prime Minister's position, and yet what we see are you know, so far hundreds, but how long this goes on, you know, who knows how many more are going to be killed this way, you know? It's not war, but this is the way the CBC is reporting it, that this is a war, a tit for tat, you know, where there's, you know, equals, you know, like these Qassam rockets, these iron rods, they're, you know, glorified bottle rockets, lethal too, though, if you get hit by one, but not explosive in the manner of, like, these house demolitions we've been seeing, you know, in Gaza these last week and a bit, or the hospitals being exploded, or any number of other examples of infrastructure being destroyed. I mean, there's no equivalence here. This is not a war. This is a massacre, you know. But this is how it's reported in our press.
Yeah, yeah. You know, we're at a time in our planet and with humanity when we face so many massive problems that the last thing we need is more fighting and more devastation and more damage to people and the environment, which of course war always does. And, you know, somehow we've got to get beyond this kind of stuff. I have no doubt that it's very, very possible and that there is a lasting peace that can happen in that area. But, I mean, we're watching essentially with the support of the United States government, and not the United States people, because they have no control over what's going on with their government, but it seems like the destruction bit by bit of that entire area of the world. Afghanistan has been devastated now for 30 years. They've been war there, started in the first place by the United States. Iraq destroyed. It's a mess. Libya bombed back into the Stone Age. Pakistan is suffering from it. Syria is being devastated, and there's no need for any of it. And behind it all, I see the people, whoever they are, the crazy people who control the government of the United States for their own evil reasons, and I don't know what those reasons are, just creating a wedge of devastation. You know, prior to 9/11, they were talking about creating a war of civilizations between the Western Christian world and the Muslim world. This was being talked about by the lunatics who speak for the government of the United States. And now, I mean, how much longer can the people in the Middle East put up with what is being done to them? It's absolutely insane.
Well, we've, you know, you forgot Somalia, Sudan, and Yemen, and Ukraine now as well.
Yeah.
In Iraq, you know, yeah, the arc of instability was that if you drew a big arcing line, you'd see in many of those countries, or all of them that you just mentioned, are along this arc. And you know, after the British left, they basically drew all these border lines that, you know, artificial countries were created, and it effectively like throwing a hand grenade over their shoulder as they got out, as the empire receded back to the British Isles. They left this situation that would guarantee that there would be nothing but conflict for generations to come, you know. Now it seems to me as the American empire's power is ebbing, that they're doing the same thing. They're going to make sure that Iraq is factionalized into three distinct areas with, you know, ethnic differences being the rule of the day, warlords, and you know, God knows what other chaos. When you talk about the environment, though, Jack, I wonder, you know, you see Iraq and Palestine, if the global warming predictions are correct, and they're pretty conservative from some of the stuff I've read, I don't know how much of land there's going to be left there anyway. I mean, they're all going to be underwater, you know. So, but you're right, we do have to get together. There's a lot bigger fish to fry on this planet, and we have to get together. And this whole warfare economy, I mean, this is what it comes down to. It's an exercise of power. And America is a desperately cornered animal right now, and we've seen the BRICS are getting together to start their own international bank. They're undercutting the IMF. The American fiat dollar is going to be, you know, worth much less than it is now, and the Canadian dollar as well. You know, so these guys are really desperate. They see the writing on the wall, and the world is moving south. It's moving away from the Northern Hemisphere and the Western dominance that we've known all of our lives. That it's coming to an end, baby, and you know, it's not going to go easily.
You know, and it's almost in terms of Canada, it's like we are being hollowed out as a first world industrial nation that we used to be, and we're being turned into a petrostate. We're being turned into a third world country from which raw materials will be extracted and nothing else. It's like our society is under attack from these corporations who control our governments and who own the media, and they're changing us from what we used to be into something that is not going to be very nice to be living in, I think.
Well, I don't agree. I think the transformation we see is changing us back to exactly what we were, which was the drawers of water, the hewers of wood. You know, Canada was not a prosperous place 100 years ago.
No, we had a golden age maybe for 30 years.
Yeah, we were a rural country. You know, 80% of the Canadians lived, you know, outside of cities. The reverse is true today. Now, the end of the industrial manufacturing sector in this country, which, you know, I mean, there's some remains, but not much. What else do we do around here? We provide services for each other, and we export vast amounts of natural resources that are limited naturally. But you know, what else do we really? What do we do? And you know, getting rid of the social, all those social safety net that was built, you know, within maybe not my lifetime, but maybe yours. You know, and that's all going back. So it's back, you know, back to the future. This is we're going to be exactly the kind of country we're, except for there won't be a lot of us living out in agricultural areas. We'll all be confined like much of the rest of the world, and especially in the emerging world, as it's more politely called. where you have people living in shanties, you know, huge numbers of people living in these mega cities because the countryside has been, you know, decimated. You know, Jack, the Trans-Pacific Partnership talks were held in Ottawa last week, speaking about...
Okay, so this is the TPP, another corporate free trade deal.
You know, like NAFTA, like the FTA, like the CETA. These are these investor rights agreements, you know. But, you know, if you look at what happened since NAFTA, you look down at Mexico and since the FTAA, the Free Trade of the Americas, which was the extension of NAFTA into Central America, basically what these investor rights agreements did was they guaranteed access of corporations to the markets down there, which allowed American agribusiness, which is hugely subsidized by the government, to dump corn, in the case of Mexico and other parts down there, massive amounts of cheap corn. And basically they drove the peasantry that lived primarily on the land off the land, and it made them go to the maquiladoras, and these are these free trade zone factories that look more like prisons, you know. It drove mass numbers of them into the cities to survive however they could. Well, this huge crime wave and this mass exodus of children, you know, from throughout Central America and Mexico, these are the fruits of these kinds of deals, right? And there's more to come. And we just get promised, well, now it's going to be the Trans-Pacific Partnership, where, you know, we're already seeing loads of Filipino workers coming in, for example, and it'll be Chinese workers and other workers coming in to Canada in great waves, because their own indigenous economy is going to suffer,
be wiped
again.
Out by this new corporate trade deal that will simply put them out of business.
And it's not going to help Canadians. I mean, these trade deals have put thousands of Canadians out of work. It's sent
probably,
you know,
more like hundreds of
thousands. Oh yeah, so, well, of course, yeah, many millions really. And then it's the same for the United States. It's done very little for the people of Mexico, or, you know, or anywhere else where these things land. But it's a great thing for the corporations. And these fascist regimes like we have in Colombia and Honduras, both of which Canada has hived off individual free trade deals with. You know, the Canadian government was the first to dive into Honduras. I mean, they were practically, you know, in the shadow of the Custers themselves, you know, before they were signing deals and recognizing this illegal and anti-democratic government in Honduras. I mean, this is the true fascism, this marriage of hard right-wing militarist ideology with the corporate bottom line ethos.
Yeah, so we're filming this on Wednesday, July 16th. Just a few days ago or a week ago, there were talks and negotiations being held in Ottawa about the TPP, kept completely secret. I didn't hear basically or see a word about it anywhere.
You know, it was tough to find. It's, you know, there's some passing mentions made of it, you know. The actual, the real scandal is that there's no access to these meetings. So there's just these corporate guys and some government insider guys. I mean, not even MPs can find out what's going on, you know. It's really kept close to the chest. I guess the media doesn't report it. Well, I mean, you can speculate, but I mean, it's pretty difficult to report on a closed door. You know, what are you going to do?
Well,
know, what
it's
are you
not difficult,
do, you know?
Because the camera can be there pointing at the closed door and leading the news and saying, what is Stephen Harper and these corporations, what are they talking about behind these closed doors? But the media's job, of course, the media is owned by the same corporations who are behind these deals, so they just pretend nothing's happening.
Yeah, well, that's what all these street protests, there wasn't even that this time. They changed the venue. It was announced to be Vancouver at first, and then it changed to Vancouver at the last, or to Ottawa at the last minute. They say that wasn't, you know, they weren't trying to, you know, hide or anything like that. Okay, if you say so. But there weren't these big demonstrations that we've seen at these other meetings. But that's the very point. They're there to say, look, bring this stuff out into the open. This has huge effects on the lives of everybody. And yet there's a small handful of faceless bureaucrats and government insiders who, you know, were on this revolving door path between industry and government, you know, giving to industry as government representatives all that they want, and then reaping their own rewards, you know, when they come out of government by working for the industries they're supposed to regulate or legislate over, you know. But barely a murmur. You know, I talked to a fellow from the Council of Canadians. And, you know, they've been on my radio show on Monday on Guerrilla Radio, but they've been at this right from the beginning. Maude Barlow and the Council of Canadians were there down in Seattle, you know, when it was the...
That's going back to about 19,
the MAI, 1998. The Multilateral Agreement on Investments. Yeah, okay. That was sort of the beginning point. Well, actually, even before that, there was the APEC meetings, which is very similar to the TPP. It was this, you know, trans-Pacific idea to do the same thing, you know, to grant powers that are traditionally held by governments to basically corporations, you know, and bye-bye democracy.
Yeah, so, I mean, we've painted kind of a pretty negative picture about what is happening, but that isn't the road we have to go down in Canada. We can do much better, but the only way we're going to do better, and it's true of, I guess, all countries, is that the people of the country have got to retake control of, in our case, we've got to retake control of our country. We've got to take it away from the corporations. We've got to take it away from the politicians. We've got to build our own media so we have some idea of what's going on. And we as a people, as a nation, have got to decide what kind of nation do we want. Do we want a nation where we are participating? Do we want a nation where we know what's going on? Do we want a nation where the politicians betray us every day because they're making their money from somebody else? You know, it really is up to us, and it's late innings. The changes have got to happen very, very quickly, and we can do something, but we've got to, we need leadership, that's for sure. I don't know where that leadership is going to come from.
Well, you know, back to Gaza, I guess, you know, as far as leadership goes, there's not a single voice in the Canadian Parliament, and that's Elizabeth May included, that, you know, really takes up the Palestinian banner. I mean, I'm sure everybody is deeply saddened and disgusted, perhaps, if they have the belly to watch the pictures of what the civilians that live there, that have already been isolated in what's widely described as an open-air prison, but, I mean, what they've suffered, you know. But there's no help. There's no, like, even, you know, Mr. Trudeau, the leader of the Liberal Party, you know, he came out with a typically jingoistic statement saying, well, Israel has to be sure that Canada's got its back, you know. I mean, as if the fourth
Trudeau
largest...
Trudeau said that too?
That's the son of Pierre Trudeau. You know, and as if the fourth largest military, a military that could step on the Canadian military in an instant, really needs the moral or the military help of Justin Trudeau. I mean, but he's also for the pipelines and such as well, right? So,
well, you don't get to be the leader of a major political party in Canada unless you do what you're told to do, and not by the people, but by the corporations. And Chris, believe it or not, that was our time. We're done.
I believe it.
Thank you very much, Chris Cook, and thanks for watching this segment of Citizens Forum. Welcome to segment two of Citizens Forum, being filmed on Wednesday, July the 16th in the Memorial Arena in beautiful Victoria. Our guest in this segment is a longtime friend and activist, Mehdi Najjari. We're going to be talking about democracy and the political system or process here in British Columbia. And Mehdi, you wanted to start off talking about a little bit about how much politicians are paid here and how that ties into so many of the important things that are happening.
Jack, I think in democracy, the politician has to be very close to the people. And if we pay the politician much higher salary than the average citizen make in a year, then we are separating the politician from average citizens. They're the reality of their life. The argument until now always was that we have to pay the politician good salary and good benefit in order to attract qualified and good politician. But there is no proof of that. There is no proof that in jurisdiction that they pay higher salaries and benefit to the politician, we get better result in terms of political result. The work of politician, the result of their work has to be reflected in the society, in the benefit to the community. that's when we know they are doing a good job. When the community, people in community, people in province, people in the city, people in the country are benefiting from those actions. We don't see that. So the question is it the salary? Is it separating the politician by giving them very good salaries and benefit? Is that helpful to the democratic process or hurtful? Is the salary make the politician more responsive to the needs of people or not? I argue it doesn't. Others until now were saying that by paying politician better, we are getting better quality politicians. Somebody was saying in the last run for increasing the pension, getting pension and increasing salaries of the politician here in BC, experts were saying that if we pay peanuts, we get monkeys. So that means if we pay better than peanuts, we get a better qualified people. First of all, the rest of the society is getting peanuts. So are we all monkeys? And next is that where is the proof that if we pay this politician, we get better result for the society? In 1994, 20 years ago, a politician, a member of legislature, were making about $49,000. One third of it was tax-free. Today, they are making $102,000. In 1994, a politician were getting, if he would quit or she would defeated in the election, she would get about $24,000 severance. Today, they are getting $127,000 severance, even if they defeated in an election.
You mean politicians get a severance package
yes.
if they lose?
Yes, $127,000. While the median income in this province for individual income earner is $27,000. The average income is around $44,000. This is way out of whack. And then we see at the same time that these increases in their salaries and benefit and getting a gold-plated pension for every dollar they put in, they get $4 the public has to put in for their pension. Why? And what result have we got? In last 25 years, have we got better situation for people, less child poverty, more security for people?
It's quite the opposite.
Exactly. In 1990s, there was this right-wing attack on the society that the corporations were saying, we cannot afford pension for the people that work for us. So there was this rush to get rid of pension, benefit corporate interest. So the politician, including the liberal politician at that time, Mr. Gordon Campbell, was the liberal opposition leader in 1995. They were all saying the politician should not have gold-plated pension. So they get rid of the pension in 1995. And then they went after the pension of everybody else because they were saying to the people, see, we politicians are getting rid of ours, so you guys have to give up yours. So a lot of private companies get rid of the pension of the people that working for them. Then in 2005, after the election of 2005, the same politician come back and demanded gold-plated pension, and they voted themselves a gold-plated pension. Meanwhile, the public lost all their pension. And my problem is not that they are having a pension. I'm saying if they are going to have a pension, everybody else deserves pension too. We cannot have just politician have a secure life, secure future, but everybody else no. Why?
You know, another danger, I think, of paying politicians too high a salary is that it makes them really dependent on that salary because it's twice as much as what they would make if they had to go back into the real world. So the politicians become desperate to hold on to their jobs. They don't want to give them up because they don't want to go from the lifestyles of the rich and famous down to what the rest of us are making. And that means that they will do anything to hold on to their job, including betraying us all of the time, which is certainly what seems to happen.
That's exactly what, another reason that they should not get paid much more than, and have benefit much more than average citizens. Because now we don't know if they are there to get their pension and everything secure, or they are there to work for serve the people of the province.
Public servants. You mentioned earlier this morning when we were talking that politicians used to be called more public servants, which suggested that their job was to serve the public.
Exactly. Now, the name was public servant. We are going to be there to serve the people, to be representative, to be the voice of the people. But now they call themselves politician. Politician is an obscure thing, you know, it has a negative, actually some negative connotation that they are playing politics. They are not really serious. We say people are playing politics, so don't take them seriously. In fact, I think if they want to change their name, they should change their name from public servant to corporate servant, because that's exactly what they are doing now. They are serving the interest of corporation over the public interest. Look at, I'm not sloganeering here. Look at Gordon Campbell. He came to power saying that we are going to have a golden decade. We are going to improve the society. What did he do? The first day he gave a huge tax cut to the corporation. The first day of government in 1991, Gordon Campbell started.
In 2001.
In 2001.
Yeah.
By giving a huge tax cut to the corporations.
Yes.
Then he sold the public asset. He gave it away, didn't sell it really. He gave away BC Rail, which was an important public asset.
Very important.
Then he signed contract well into future, 30 years into future, with those independent power producers.
Put us on the hook for $50
billion. $55 billion signing contract, yeah, to buy electricity three times market price from these friend of his, that he gave away the streams and rivers of this province to.
All and kept completely out of the media.
And then what's happened? When he went out of office, the day he left, he was eligible for $98,000 pension a year. $98,000 pension a year. This is corruption. This is not democracy. This is not public service. And we have to stand up and say no. Because if in 1994 they were making $49,000 salary, and today they are making $102,000, that's about two times, more than two times. Did anybody else, any other sector of the society, like teachers, that every time they are fighting them to give them 001 or 011, you know, did they get two times salary since 1994, or anybody else?
Well, I'm sure some people have. Some people in our society have done very well. Most working people have seen relatively small pay increases, to the point where really, when you take inflation into account, people's wages are going down.
Exactly. The inflation was in average 2% a year. In 20 years, that's about 50% reduction in purchasing power.
Yeah.
And again, the median income, half of the individual income earner in this province make less than $27,000-$28,000 a year.
What do you think about the idea of term limits for politicians?
That's not going to by itself really improve things. But if we want to improve our democracy, I think we have to make our politician much closer to the average citizens in terms of income. And also, there should be some level of accountability, constant accountability. When in 2007, the politician came after the election of 2005, and the election was in May. Within 2 weeks after the election in May of 2005, they created a secret committee to raise their own pay and bring the pension back that they gave away in 19.
And that secret committee was the NDP,
NDP
and the Liberals
and
together.
Liberals. Yeah. They said and they agreed to increase their wages by 15% and bring a gold-plated pension back. But in November, they passed the motion in the legislature and the legislature was shut down for the Christmas. But the people started speaking out, so they had to rescind that legislation. In January of 2007, Gordon Campbell designated a committee of so-called citizens, independent committee, that would look at the issue of the salaries of and pension of the politician. They had three members, one was a Supreme Court judge, retired Supreme Court judge Josiah Wood. Another person was the chair of it was a lawyer, and the third was a professor of business from UBC. These are not ordinary citizens. These are highest paying people in the province to look at the salaries of the MLAs. And they come back in May. They went around the province. They had about seven meetings, and 34 people were there, and I was one of them. I remember I was in Victoria, went to their meetings, and spoke out against the increases. And they came back with a report to increase, instead of 15% increase for the salary of the MLAs, they increased it by 29% and get a very generous pension. I remember at the time I said to the panel, if you are gonna increase their salaries, at least make them more responsible and accountable to the voters. They should have every month a public meeting for 2 hours, face their constituents on the record, give a report about what they have done in preceding months, what are the important issues are being discussed, and important issues that people should know about, and then listen for an hour and a half to the problems that people are encountering.
You know, Mehdi, you started telling me, you first told me about that idea years ago, and at the time I didn't really think much of it. But as the years have gone by, I think it's more and more important. All you're saying is that the politicians we elect, the politicians we pay, should meet with us once a month for 2 hours on the record and speak to the citizens, but it never,
and
they
listen
won't
to them.
Do it.
And listen to
listen.
Them.
More importantly, yes. Listen.
And believe me, none of them is going to accept that.
No,
because until now, I have been saying this since 1995. Yeah. This is one solution to maybe create more democracy and more and bring people back to the political scene. We have seen this, for example, after the federal election in 2011, Elizabeth May have series of meeting every year. She has about 20 meetings, 10 or 11 in the winter and 10 and 11 at the end of the summer with her constituents, because her constituency is very big and included several islands and so on and so forth. In every meeting that I went to those accountability sessions, she called it, and it should be called accountability session, the meetings are packed. In the middle of summer, in the middle of August, she had meeting and it was packed. In the winter, in January, I went to a meeting, it was packed. So people are interested, but politicians don't want to encourage people to come to the scene. That's why election after election, we see less and less people participation in the election. Because they realize, people are realizing, it doesn't matter who they vote for. They are gonna promise us everything before election. After the election, they do everything to us instead of doing for us. So this is one way to increase that accountability.
Well, aside from Elizabeth May, is there any other politician here in BC that you know of that's doing this kind of a thing?
No, but for example, I should say about the politician that just recently got elected in city of Seattle.
Right.
Her name is Kashma Savant. She got elected on a socialist platform in United States, which is incredible. She said, I'm a socialist. and I am running, and these are my platform. And one of the platform was that she said she is gonna take home only average income that the citizens of Seattle make. So what is the average income for city of Seattle? It's about $40,000. What is the salary of councilor of city of Seattle? $117,000 a year.
Huge salary.
And she is taking only $40,000 home because she want to leave the reality of life of average citizen. This is amazing, you know. A politician give away 2/3 of her salary.
Unheard of.
Because she really want to serve people. That's why I'm saying, maybe if we reduce the salaries of politicians, we get people, only people who will run are the ones that really want to affect body politics for the interest of the public.
Now, you mentioned that this young lady who was elected in Seattle, she was the one who began the push for the $15 an hour minimum wage in Seattle.
Yes, and she's only one councilor.
Right.
Among 15 or 20, I don't know how many, in city of Seattle. But she got, because she promised during the election that she's going to push for minimum wage of $15, she got the whole council supporting that now.
And it's been passed.
And it's passed. And also, it's now the city of San Francisco is considering, and other jurisdiction is considering. So she is really affecting and increasing the benefit to the lowest income earners.
Yes.
And that's the way to really improve the economy, because when the people get a better wages, they are going to spend that money.
Exactly.
And create a better economy. When you give tax cut to the rich, they're going to save all that money and nothing come back to the society. They were telling us about the trickle down economy, which is a bunch of baloney. It was baloney during the 1980 when Reagan said it, and it's baloney today. So let's do the real things for the public. So to the NDP opposition, because liberals are saying that they support big business. You know, they never deny that. But for the opposition that claim that they are the voice of the ordinary citizens, average citizen, so I like to know from those 32, 33 MLA, NDP MLA, how many of them are willing to have every month public meeting facing their constituents and listening to them on the record for 2 hours every month? What's the problem? You are getting $102,000 a year plus when we cost the benefit is much, much higher than that, you know? For example, if NDP house leader get much more money than $102,000. And so on, and if they sit in the committee, they get more, and so on and so forth. So what's the problem?
Well, I'd like to suggest that people watching this show contact your local MLA or your city councilor and your MP and tell them you expect them to have a meeting with you once a month with the people who elected them and stand in front of the citizenry and talk and listen. I mean, I've come to the conclusion that, it's a good idea, and the fact that nobody except for Elizabeth May is doing it.
To some extent, but when you are a provincial politician, there is no reason not to do it every month. And imagine, you go there and ask a question, the politician say, oh, I don't know. But next month he has to come back with the answer, yeah. You know? So there is everything on the record.
That's right. It has to be on the record. It has to be
yes.
on the
they,
record.
Yes, they can put it on their website so everybody can, if the people that didn't go to the meeting can go and visit. What's happened?
And there's no reason that some of them can't be filmed and shown,
sure.
Either streamed or on television, and people can watch what's going on, because we need that kind of a reality, because our politicians have left us behind. They, for the most part, don't seem to really care.
They're not interested. As long as their lot is with the big, they have good income and benefit, they don't have pain. Not the pain, they don't understand the pain of the ordinary citizens.
Yeah. I mean, there's certainly other things we can do to improve our democracy. I'd like to see the strength of the political parties weakened.
You see, for example, the issue of the teachers. The Supreme Court, the judge in Supreme Court, Judge Susan Griffin, really condemned this government. This government sabotaging for many years now their negotiation with teachers because they want to force the teachers to go to a strike. They want to create chaos. We have document from the government that when they are hiring managers for their different department, one of the conditions for the managers, for example, in 2010, this is an application for jobs. One of the requirements for the executive that they want to hire is that executive create a crisis to force change. The executive have the ability to create crisis to force change. They are creating crisis. What kind of change do they want to see? They want to get rid of of public system of education and push it toward private system.
And this is this page is entitled "The Executive Role Profile of the BC Public Service," and it says executives anticipate and are prepared to institute change quickly. At times, to capitalize on the best opportunity, executives create a crisis to force change.
So in the Supreme Court yes. proceeding, it's very clear Judge Griffin is really condemning the.
So this is the BC Supreme Court BC Supreme Court
Justice.
Justice Susan Griffin, and she is talking about what happened between the BCTF and the provincial government back in 2011, 2012, which is the last time there was trouble between the government and the teachers. And this is a story from the Globe and Mail. It says, the documents focus on testimony given in court by the government's chief negotiator, Paul Strazak. Mr. Strazak is asked on the stand when he's testifying, so your objective as government was to increase the pressure on the teachers to have them go out on a full-scale strike. Is that correct? Mr. Strazak answered, yes, I'll say that's correct. So in 2011, 2012, the government's position was to put pressure on the teachers put them on strike.
A strike, yes.
This was testified to in the BC Supreme Court, and yet that whole idea seems to have been lost now. All we hear about in the media is the teacher's strike, teacher's strike, teacher's strike. But the idea that the government pushed the teachers to strike is never mentioned, even though it came out in open testimony in BC Supreme Court. And it says in the Globe story, this is the government's chief negotiator talking about a plan to put tens of thousands of kids out of school to fulfill the government's political agenda. One more time, the government's chief negotiator talking about a plan to deliberately put tens of thousands of kids out of school to fulfill the government's political agenda, which was to create a strike so that they could then bring in a very hard line against the teachers, which is exactly where we are now, 2 or 3 years later. It's an amazing situation. And the other thing the government's saying is that there's no money. Which is
the money is not there because they gave tax cut to the corporations. That's why.
The Liberal government has cut taxes in this province by about $7 billion a year, with the biggest cuts going to the richest people and the biggest corporations in the province. And Mr. Fassbender, our Minister of Education, comes out and says, we have an obligation to balance the budget or deal with the budget. It's all a pack of nonsense, and yet it's effective because the media won't tell us, and even the BCTF won't say it.
Yes, I think we have only a minute or so left, so I wanted just to mention what's happening in Palestine. It's really height of cowardice for a country with the fourth strongest military in the world attacking defenseless people in Gaza. We are being lied to by the media here. Mr. Sasha Petroshevsk of the CBC 2 days ago were reporting, showing a destroyed mosque and saying that the Israeli were saying that it was a supposedly a secret weapon facility. But the worshipper denying that. But Mr. Petroshevsk is right there. He can see. He can verify if it was a secret weapon facility or not, but he doesn't say anything. We see Israelis are attacking the hospitals, for the handicapped children. Today, in Gaza Beach, four children, Palestinian children, were killed while they were playing soccer. This is criminal, what's happening. And our government is in total support of these war crimes. And I really think we as a Canadian should stand up to our own government and say no to these war crimes, because
you know, there is a group called Independent Jewish Voices.
Yes.
A group of Jewish people who are speaking out against what's going on.
There is many Jews. John Pilger, Noam Chomsky, Ilan Pappé, Amira Haas, Gedeon Levy, Richard Falk, all intellectual journalists, well-known, well-loved by the people of the world, all condemning.
And not one word in the Canadian media
about any of them. The criminal actions of the state of Israel, and not one word in our media.
Many were out of time, I'm sorry. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Citizens Forum.